All right, so let us take up one final question before we start the next concept. You have a hemisphere. Okay, draw a hemisphere. This is a hemisphere. The radius of the hemisphere is R. Fine, radius is R. Okay, the hemisphere is smooth. All right, you are keeping a very small mass over here. Okay, a very small mass is you're keeping there, and then you are slightly nudging it. You just slightly touched it and it starts going down. Getting it? So what will happen? It will move down along the sphere. All right, and at some angle it will leave the sphere. Fine. So it may not move all the time along the sphere only. So there is a point where it leaves the hemisphere. Fine. So let's say that angle is theta with the vertical. Fine. You need to find what is the angle theta at which this mass m leaves the hemisphere. Okay. Try to do this. Okay, you need to find the angle theta at which the mass m will leave the hemisphere. Bharat got one of the answers. Others, those who agree with Bharat can say that, okay, Bharat's answer is correct. Yeah, I'll solve it. Everybody tried this? Okay, what is the condition? When the mass... Just tell me the condition when it will leave the hemisphere. No, Bharat. Yes, all the contact forces goes to zero because it is losing the contact, right? So since it is losing the contact, so contact forces will become equal to zero. Fine. So what are the contact forces here? There is only one contact force, that is normal reaction out here. So normal reaction, when it becomes zero, that's the point when it leaves the hemisphere. Okay, so all the contact forces, even if there is a friction, even friction force will become zero at that moment. Fine. Okay, now if suppose it has a velocity v at that moment, let's say it has a velocity v at that moment. Okay, then since it is moving in a circle before leaving the hemisphere, it will have an acceleration of v square by r towards the center. So this one will be the acceleration. So if you draw the free body diagram of this mass, you will have mg like this, and then you'll have a centripetal acceleration v square by r. Getting it? And this angle will also be theta. Fine. So if you draw this mg force, this angle will be equal to that angle. All right. So the force along the direction of radius is what? Mg cos theta. Fine. This force should be equal to mass time acceleration. So mv square by r. All right. So I am just ignoring the normal reaction. Normal reaction goes to zero when it leaves the surface. Fine. So this equation should be true at the point when it leaves the surface. Okay. If it is not leaving the surface, then what will be the equation? Mg cos theta minus normal reaction. This is the net force. This net force will become mv square by r. But at this moment, normal force is becoming zero. So mg cos theta is mv square by r. All right. So this is the condition for which it will leave the hemisphere. Now what I'll do, I'll write work energy theorem between point 1 and point 2. Okay, so work done by all the forces will be equal to change in the kinetic energy. What is mg cos theta? Beta, mg cos theta is the component of mg along the direction of acceleration. Component of mg along the direction of acceleration is mg cos theta. Fine. Ashutosh, let me answer if anybody asks me. So Mg is acting downwards. Its component along this direction is Mg cos theta. Anyways, so work done by all the forces will be equal to change in kinetic energy, which is half mv square. Half mv square is the final kinetic energy, right? And initial kinetic energy is zero. Fine. So this is equation one and that is equation number two. All right. Now I need to find the work done. Who all are doing work? Is normal reaction doing any work when it is sliding down? Normal reaction is perpendicular to the displacement all the while. Okay, displacement is tangential, normal reaction is perpendicular to that. So work done by normal reaction is zero. The only force that is doing work here is work done by gravity. Fine. This is equal to mg multiplied by this displacement, which is along the direction of gravity. Okay, let's call it as y. So y will become how much? This total length is r, fine, and this much is r cos theta, fine. You can see that there is a right angle triangle over here. So this length from here to here, this length is r cos theta. So y is equal to r minus r cos theta. So 1 minus cos theta times r, fine. So work done by gravity is mgr 1 minus cos theta, fine. So all you have to do is just substitute there. Mgr 1 minus cos theta is the work done by gravity. This is equal to half mv square, all right. And how much should be half mv square? So if you look at here, you know, half mv square should be equal to mgr cos theta by 2. Okay, I'm just utilizing this equation. So I would like to write mv square in terms of mgr, because mgr will get cancelled out from left hand side. Okay, this is equal to mgr by 2 into cos theta. Fine. So now you just have to solve. So cos theta will come out to be 2 by 3. Fine. So theta is cos inverse 2 by 3. Fine. Any doubt with respect to this question, please type in. Okay. How I get y? First of all, you need to understand y is what? Y is a displacement of this mass when it goes there along the direction of mg. Because in order to find the work done by gravity, I need to find how much it has displaced along the direction of gravity. Fine. So you can see that there is a right angle triangle. Okay. From here to here, this length is r. Okay. This angle is theta. And since this is 90 degree, this length is r cos theta. Getting it? So I know from here to there, topmost point, the distance is r, and from there to here, the distance is r cos theta. Fine. So the y is equal to r minus r cos theta. Right. So that's how you get the value of r. So that's how you get the value of y. Okay. Okay. You just have to solve this, guys. You'll get cos inverse 2 by 3. Okay. So cos theta will come out to be 2 minus 2 cos theta. So 2 cos theta, you get it that side, you get 3 cos theta is equal to 2, and cos theta is equal to 2 by 3. How you got the value of work done by mg? See, work done by mg is force mg multiplied by displacement along the direction of force, which is r into 1 minus cos theta. Okay, so we have got the value of y just like that. Fine. So I'll just make this figure a little bit more clearer. So I'll draw it here. So mass goes along an arc like this. Fine. So this is r and that is also r, and this is theta. Fine. So if I drop a perpendicular from here, this is 90 degree, this length will be what? R cos theta, this length, okay? And I need to find that length, which is y, right? The total length is r. So y is equal to r minus r cos theta. That y is the displacement along the direction of gravity. So like this, you get this particular work done. Okay. Okay. Shall we move to next? Let's move to next concept now. We are talking about conservative and non-conservative forces. Write down. Achha, by the way, that work energy theorem that we have derived, which is work done, is equal to K2 minus K1. Okay. You can apply this theorem at a frame of reference where the reference frame is at rest. Okay. Or the reference frame can move with a constant velocity also. Fine. So if reference frame moves with a constant velocity, then you'll observe relative velocity. So the measurement of kinetic energy will change if you are observing the object with respect to a frame that is moving with constant velocity. Fine. Not only kinetic energy will change, but the work done will also change, because then you'll see a different displacement. Getting it? So that is slightly more involved. When you solve questions, you will encounter such scenarios where if you change the frame, then the question gets solved easily. Fine. So we'll take up questions like that, changing frame of reference to find the kinetic energy later part of when we revise or when we revisit this chapter, we'll take up those scenarios. Okay. All right. But then your frame of reference cannot accelerate. If it accelerates, there'll be pseudo force. And pseudo force also does the work. Fine. So pseudo force is another concept that I will have to take separately, that I have not yet discussed. Fine. So I'm just telling you so that, you know, if you are if you want to move ahead, you know, don't hesitate. You can ask me individually also in case you want to. Okay. Bharat is asking something. Yeah, I just discussed that. All right, so we are talking about conservative and non-conservative forces. Now the forces can be, you know, broadly classified into conservative and non-conservative forces depending on how you calculate or how the work done by the forces will behave. Okay, so if, write down, if work done by a force independent of frame, independent of the path taken and only depends on initial and final points. Okay. Then the force is conservative. Fine. So you'll soon understand why we are defining conservative and non-conservative force. Right now, just take it as a definition. Okay. Now suppose this is point one. Okay. And that is point two. Fine. Now you are going from point one and two. Suppose you're going like this. And then you are reaching point two like this. Getting it? So it doesn't matter what path you take. If initial and final points, they are same, then the work done by the force does the same work. I mean, the work done by the force will be same in both the paths. Let's say this is path 1 and this is path 2. Okay, although the displacement is independent of path. Okay, displacement will be what? From point 1 and 2, displacement will be this only. This is the displacement. Okay, and if it is a constant force, fine. So if the force is constant, anyways, you know, it will be independent of the path, because displacement, you have to take the dot product with the force. Fine. So displacement is independent of path and force is a constant force. So F dot displacement will give you the work done. Fine. But I'm talking about in a generic sense, even if the force can change its magnitude and direction both. In that case also, there are few forces, okay, for which the work done by the force is independent of the path. It only depends on initial and final points. Okay, so in that case, that force is the conservative force. Fine. But in a case where the work done by a force depends on the path taken by the particle or an mass or a mass, then that force is not a conservative force. Fine. Now, how you test whether a force is conservative or not? You test whether a force is conservative or not by just finding the work done. Just find out work done by a force if an object moves in a loop. What do you think the work done by conservative force will be? If an object moves in a loop, let's say object moves in a circle, okay, like this. So in one full circle, how much will be the work done by the conservative force? It will be zero, because initial and final points are same. Okay, so work done by the conservative force in a closed loop will always be zero. Getting it? Fine. Now, I'll just take one example of non-conservative force so that you can understand the difference. Take an example of this. This is an enclosure. It's a spherical enclosure. It is a hollow sphere. You're taking a mass from here. Okay, you're taking a mass, all right, you are pushing it, right, from both sides, from top and the bottom, and this object moves like this, goes to the top. When it goes to the top, you're pushing it like this, okay, and you're making sure it completes one full circle. It starts from one and comes to the same point. So initial and final point both are the same. Fine. So is the work done by friction zero? Work done by friction, is it zero? It is not zero, right? Friction will do some work. Friction will do some work. All right, so friction is a force which is, you can say, an example of non-conservative force. Fine. So it depends on what path you have taken when you calculate the work done by the friction. So you'll see that all the while when it is sliding up, when it is sliding up, friction is always in opposite direction of displacement. So you should add up the small work done by the friction. All the small work done by the friction will be a negative quantity. So all the negative quantity cannot add up and equal to zero. Fine. So there will be a net work done by the friction, which is negative. Because all the small work done by the friction, they are negative. So you just add them up, it will never become zero. Fine. So work done by the friction is not zero when it moves in a closed loop. So friction is an example of non-conservative force. Okay. Now take an example of gravity. What is the gravity force? Mg. Mg is the gravity force and it is always acting vertically down. Okay. So what is the work done by the gravity force? Work done by Mg force. What it is right now? How much is the displacement along the direction of gravity? It will be zero. In case your connection is failed, please come live and watch it. Okay, you can revisit what you have left later on. Okay, Niranjan is saying minus mg into 2r. Niranjan, if you are talking about point 1 and let's say this is point 3. So if the object goes from the bottommost point to the topmost point, then the work done by the gravity is minus mg into 2r, because the displacement along the it is now against the direction of gravity. Actually, this is the displacement, which is 2r, and gravity is acting downwards. Fine. So mg is downward and displacement is 2r against it. So minus mg into 2r when the object goes from 1 to 3. Fine. But if I'm saying that object comes back, the displacement becomes zero. It goes up by 2r and comes back by 2r. So displacement is zero. Okay. So work done by the gravity is zero. Fine. So gravity could be an example of a conservative force. Fine. So we'll take up a couple of more examples and we'll ascertain that the gravity is the conservative force, and then we'll analyze it further.